canopy of Wisconsin summer skies. The Kansas City Chiefs' 1995 season began in the college town of River Falls.
I don't know if y'all qualified to go against me here. We're gonna tear your ass up. I'm gonna jump you.
Unanswered questions swirled around this seventh summer camp under Marty Schottenheimer. Who would replace future Hall of Famer Joe Montana at quarterback? And how would the defense respond to the installation of a completely new system? These were just a few of the questions left hanging as the Chiefs started out on the uncertain journey into their new season. This was a team that was severely underestimated by preseason pollsters. One went so far as to facetiously rank them sixth in their five-team division race. And always, the media pointed to the biggest question mark, the void at quarterback, and whether perennial backup Steve Bono could successfully fill it.
Everybody is welcome to their own opinion, but within the Chiefs huddle, we've always believed in ourselves, and the only way you can make those people shut up is win.
Join the circle! Let's tie the circle together, and let's get it done! Start fast, finish strong! Oh!
The Chiefs did indeed start fast and finish strong, rising above their critics by winning an NFL high 13 games and making the playoffs for an unprecedented sixth straight season. Opening day in Seattle, Steve Bono eased any doubts, passing for nearly 300 yards and three touchdowns.
20, 15, 10, touchdown Chiefs! 60-yard touchdown pass, Bono to Davis!
But a starting quarterback wasn't the only new weapon in the 1995 Chiefs arsenal.
Merrick Vanover has it at the 1, comes up the left hash mark, 15, he's up to the 20, shoots 1, 2, 3, tackles, here he goes, 35, 40, 45, 50, Merrick Vanover, 40, 30, 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown, 100 yards! Kickoff return by Tamarick Vanover. He did it in his first collegiate game. He does it in his first professional game.
With the route, the Chiefs' quest for respect was successfully launched.
I see USA Today. I see all you people that commented on Chiefs without Montana ain't really nothing. We got a team now. Everybody contributes on a team. 6-5, huh? Sixth place in the five division. Okay. Okay.
Don't ever underestimate us, baby.
How you doing, baby?
Don't ever underestimate us.
The next Sunday was the home opener, where a capacity crowd welcomed the latest addition of the team to Arrowhead Stadium. Unfortunately, the Chiefs immediately handed a large lead to the New York Giants.
Goes to the near side in the end zone, touchdown New York, wide open Chris Callaway.
With the team trailing 17-3 late in the fourth quarter, it was the perfect time for Steve Bono to step up. His first major test as the starting quarterback. Bono responded with a performance reminiscent of his heralded predecessor. Employing short, crisp passes, he completed 9 straight on one scoring drive. Then a minute later, led his team downfield for the tying touchdown. En route, he converted a pair of fourth down situations with calm, flawless decision-making. Seven yards later, Bono completed the comeback, tying the game and sending it to overtime.
Bono looking to pass the football, goes in the middle, pass is cut, touchdown Kansas City, touchdon Chiefs, touchdown Chiefs.
Danon Hughes took the bullet over the middle from Steve Bono.
Keep working now. Keep it up.
We're going to win this ball, baby. We're going to win this, baby. One time, baby. One time. Let's go. Let's go, fellas. One time.
In overtime, sudden death proved fatal to the Giants.
Lenny Lane will try a 24-yard field goal to win the game in overtime. 17-17, the snap is down, the kick is up by Elliott. The kick is good, and one thing is now for certain, Lazarus is a Chief fan, because the Chiefs came from the dead today. The Chiefs win it 20-17 in overtime.
The next week, against arch-rival Oakland, the Chiefs again fell behind early.
Let's go, A-Mark! One play at a time, let's go!
Once again, Steve Bono's fourth-quarter passing precision brought them back from the brink of oblivion. Equally important was the performance of a relentless defensive unit that kept the Raiders out of the end zone for the entire second half. The result was, for the second consecutive week, a Chiefs game was tied at 17 points at the end of regulation.
Now, come here. I want to tell you something. You have dominated them to this point. You have dominated them in the kicking game. We got to dominate them one more play.
There's going to be a big ball come out of here in a hurry.
Alert our secondary. Let's go.
For the second straight week, overtime proved to be a golden opportunity as a key free agent acquisition, James Hasty, dramatically paid his first dividend.
Up and late, intercepted. Intercepted by James Hasty. He's at the 50. He's at the 40. Hasty at the 30. He's at the 15. Touchdown! 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 Touchdown to win the game. James Hasty, 62-yard intercepted return for a touchdown. Welcome to Kansas City, James Hasty. Kansas City wins in overtime. 62-yard interception return for a touchdown.
Three weeks later, the overtime fireworks continued on a Monday night. A national television audience saw Steve Bono pass for a season-high 329 yards and a pair of touchdowns against the Chargers. Still, it took yet another come-from-behind effort by the offense to tie the game with 57 seconds left on the clock. It soon became apparent that overtime had become showtime for the 95 Chiefs.
Marek Vanover, that walking stick of dynamite, is waiting to light the fuse again.
It'll be taken by Vanover at the 15. He's in trouble. Shed one tackle, trying to get the outside.
Kansas City has tied a record. Three overtime victories in a season.
Rookie Tamarik Vannevar's electrifying game breaker not only gave the Chiefs a record of 5-1, it marked them as a force to be reckoned with in the NFL.
Some teams that become great teams, you become great by winning a bunch of close games. This is an incredibly confident team right now in their own ability.
On all three of those games, there were different players, groups of players that made different things happen. And I think after that, those three games, it built a confidence within ourselves that, hey, we've been down before, let's do it again.
5-1, and heading toward the glory, baby.
These guys look like they have Elvis on their helmet. What USFL team is this?
Bledsoe, here comes the rush from the outside. He's tackled.
After the first three home games were won in overtime, K KC went conventional against the Patriots.
Play action fake by Bono. Steps up, looks over the middle. Turns for the end zone. Bono has got it. Touchdown, Kansas City Chiefs. Bono takes the snap. Back into the pocket quickly. Steps up, fires for the end zone. Davis is there.
Chiefs were now 6-1 for the first time since their 1969 Super Bowl season. Amidst a swirling snowstorm in Denver's Mile High Stadium, one player turned an off track into a fast track. Marcus Allen, making sure-footed cuts behind textbook blocking, blinded the Broncos with 121 yards. It included an historic 100th career rushing touchdown.
And in the snow, the legends of Walter Payton, John Riggins, and Jim Brown wait for him, the only four men in the history of the National Football League to have 100 rushing touchdowns.
The Chiefs' defense was equally successful. They manhandled a Bronco attack that had exploded for 900 yards and 64 points their previous two games. This snowy day, John Elway and friends only scored once.
Intercepted by Carter. Carter at the 10, 15. Carter up the 20, 25. And up the left sideline. Bumped out of bounds at the 35-yard line. Dale Carter with another interception. Shut the door. Close the deal. Kansas City with a huge defensive play. Second turnover of the game.
Now 7-1, the Chiefs had beaten every team in their division, and their confidence was increasing every game.
I know that we're a team with a lot of character, and we're learning more about ourselves and finding out a great deal about what we're made of and what we can become.
We got to try to find a way to get ignited.
Got to have a tempo, man. Got to have a tempo. All right, man, let's go to work. Let's go, man. Let's go. One play at a time. Let's go. Everybody up. We know the strength of this team is this team. We're going to 8-1. Mile marker 9. We started at the beginning with one phrase. Focus, finish. Let's go.
Washington was the next victim.
It's a run to Kimball Anders, 30-yard line, sweep left, 35, 30 in the open field. 25, 20, he's going to outrace everybody in the end zone. Kimball Anders from 40 yards out, touchdown, Kimball Anders.
Hey, DT, let's go. Three and out or a touchdown for us.
Kansas City's defense reduced the Redskins to rubble, holding them without a single touchdown.
Protection breaks down. Derek Thomas has it. Wraps him to the ground with a loss.
The Chiefs' impressive record had improved to an NFL best 8-1.
Let's remember what I said. Those two little letters, W-E-W-E, those two little letters, U-S, us, they're powerful. They're powerful. Great job. That's it.
7 days later in San Diego, the Chiefs defeated the Chargers for the second time.
Keep going, give the hell, let's go get the ball!
They play action, fake to Marcus Allen, rolling right as Bono. He's going to tuck the football, sprints to the far side, touchdown Steve Bono! His fourth rushing touchdown this season!
Steve Bono ran for one of only two Kansas City touchdowns. They were enough because the defense allowed the Chargers into the end zone just once all afternoon. This sixth consecutive victory increased the record to a lofty 9-1. Next came a Sunday night meeting with the Houston Oilers.
Bono rolling to the right side. Chiefs flood the right side with receivers. Bono holds, throws late. Touchdown on the near side. Webster slaughtered.
For a while, it appeared the Chiefs were headed for their fourth overtime of the season. But a funny thing happened only 15 seconds away from sudden death.
He's up to the 20. He's at the 25, 30. McNair fumbles the ball. He fumbles it. Picked up. Picked up by Mark Collins. 25, 20. Collins can't find. Touchdown, Kansas City. The Miracle Chiefs.
do it again! 33-yard fumble return! Can you believe this football team?
No.
Unbelievable!
Their seventh straight win brought the NFL's best record to 10-1. In Week 14, the Chiefs visited the friendly environs of the Oakland Coliseum.
They were worse than L.A. They were worse than Oakland.
The fans didn't love them. They're going to love us even more when we get to put this rubbing on.
We're going for the division today, baby. It's all about winning this division.
Raiders cry. 1, 2, 3,
in this vintage rivalry, the day belonged not to the Raiders, but to Marcus Allen, who haunted his former team with his biggest day of the season.
42, counterplay. Up the middle goes to Marcus Allen, tiptoeing through 50-yard line. Breaks the left side, 45-40. Marcus Allen across the 35, being chased, and finally tomahawk down. A run of 38 yards. Marcus Allen trying the left side and breaks a tackle of Hoskins at the 15-yard line inside the 10. He broke three Oakland Raider tackles, a gain of 25 yards. Marcus Allen right side spins into the end zone. Touchdown, Marcus Allen. His 125th touchdown. He's now tied with Jim Brown and Walter Payton on the all-time NFL list.
He was not, I say he was not going to be denied that time.
Hey, you score one more time, might as well give him a pillow because they're going to lay down. Take a work.
We can't have it next week. We got to have it today. Let's go.
Well, they at the 30-yard line. Evans throws the football, intercepted in the left flat by Washington. 40 up to the 50s in the open field. See ya, Oakland Raiders. Brian Washington goes all the way. Touchdown, Kansas City.
Put that nail in that coffin now.
Hey, this is the best. You can't get no better than this.
The Chiefs win the AFC Western Division with 21 shopping days still until Christmas.
Today was a special day to come here in Oakland and beat them on their own turf and beat them bad.
Finally, best in the West.
Hey, let's go. This is very brief, man. We want to get the hell out of this dungeon. Listen to me. Now, hold on a second. Just hold on. Tell you what, there's a lot of guys that stepped up today. I mean, a lot of guys that stepped up big time. It's in the books. Kansas City Chiefs, 11-2. AFC, yeah. Western. Yeah. Yeah.
Incredibly, Marty Schottenheimer's teams have made the playoffs in 10 of the 11 years he's been a head coach.
Hold it. Carl's got something.
I'm going to give the first one to the head coach of the team they picked to come in sixth place in a five-team division.
You have a record for everybody, man. Everybody.
Yes!
I would be less than candid if I didn't say it wasn't a little bit special to be able to win the division against them, because clearly they were everybody's preseason pick, not only to win the AFC West, but also to win the AFC Conference.
Well, let's keep on going. Let's keep on going.
Bono takes the snap, makes a handoff, bootleg, play to the right side.
In the season's next to last week, the Chiefs had just enough offense to squeeze by the Denver Broncos.
Steve Bono, his fifth rushing touchdown of the season. That's a new Kansas City Chief record.
The defense made the big plays.
No way to throw. Looking right, being chased. He hit the ball, flying free. The ball's free.
Mark Booker's got it. Rolls inside the 10. Spins off a man. Touchdown! Touchdown! Touchdown, Kansas City! Vaughn Booker! The defense does it again for the Kansas City Chiefs, forcing a turnover, getting a touchdown.
It was the first time the Chiefs beat the Broncos twice in one season in 16 years. The season ended as it began, against the Seattle Seahawks.
Chiefs are coming at you, the best team in the AFC.
We're going to have a win today. We're going to be number one.
Who saved us that star-spangled
Finish!
In the regular season finale, the home team played close to a perfect game.
Vandover takes it at the 11. Merry Christmas, 2025. Purdy explodes to the 35. There he goes, 45, 50. He could go all the way. Merry Christmas, Kansas City! Come on, Vandover did it against the Seahawks in week four. He does it on Christmas Eve. 89-yard kickoff return. Touchdown, Kansas City!
I guess that answered our question as to whether the Chiefs were ready to play or not, huh?
On the opening kickoff, the special teams had set the tone. And for the rest of the game, the Chiefs capped the finest regular season in team history with a textbook blend of defensive and offensive superiority.
Pattern near side, come on, Vandover, has a touchdown for the second time in the first half.
Man, where the hell are y'all been?
All day long, work, 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 baby, this is a job.
Let's go now, don't let him get anything started, don't encourage him anyway.
A smothering defense held Chris Warren to just 7 yards. The Seahawks totaled just 89.
What a defensive effort. They are on their feet and applauding the defense, which is having a curtain call. 89 yards of total offense, an all-time Kansas City Chief record. This game's over, and you listen to me closely. It's the first time a team has gone undefeated in its division since the 1985 Chicago Bears. Kansas City goes 8-0 in the AFC Western Division. More importantly, Kansas City has the best record in the National Football League.
When there were all the doubts, not only around the country, but maybe even the minds of some of the people in our community, we said, there is no reason to talk. There's but an opportunity to do. And that's what you men have done.
To have the type of season they've had is just a remarkable job, not only by Schottenheimer.
Hey, who's got the best record in football?
But by the players on this team who kind of stared reality in the face and said, no, we're not going down. We're going to win.
Since you said it all, we're going to keep this brief. We just simply say thank you. 13th of your month.
Lenny, first of all, was drafted number one by the Pittsburgh Steelers, Buddy Parker, and really didn't play any. He threw about 20 passes, I think, in a three-year span of time.
For a couple of years, I was the understudy to Bobby Lane. Now, if you want to learn the proper techniques of quarterbacking, the last guy you would go to would be Bobby Lane. So I developed some terrible habits. The accuracy, the touch, the release was no longer there. I didn't know it, but I had developed some real bad habits. Paul Brown had wanted me when I was in college at Purdue, and going over to Cleveland, my job was to back up Milt Plum. Paul Brown really wasn't looking for a quarterback because he was featuring the running game, and so I could see that I wasn't going to get an opportunity to play. And I hadn't signed the contract, and so he calls me, well, you know, what are you going to do? You sign this contract or else. I mean, you had no choice in those days. And I said, I'd just get out of here.
So Paul said, okay, fine, Leonard, I'll put you on waivers. He said, as a fellow coach, I want you to know that I don't think Lenny can play football in the National Football League. I said, well, I appreciate that very much, Paul, but I'm still going to take him.
Hank Stram was utilizing the running game. He was utilizing the things that I did best. My ball handling was very good. With play-action passes really helped because of my ability to handle the football. I could throw on the move, both left and right. And so Hank started featuring that phase of the game. And my strong suit was accuracy. I could throw the ball accurately, and I could throw the ball accurately up to 50 yards.
Lenny just was a great judgment thrower. He threw the ball with great, you know, touch on it. Lenny would throw the ball maybe 10 yards ahead. I used to love to run under balls and catch the ball with reach. You know, Lenny wasn't a bullet-type passer for 60, 70 yards. He threw a softball.
A natural leader, a very, very deceptive leader in that he was quiet, but very demanding. When he spoke, they listened because he was always, always under control. I said to him one day, I said, Leonard, make sure that you never let them see you sweat. And he said, Coach, quarterbacks don't sweat. Quarterbacks perspire.
Lenny was the man. You know, he was the man. He had taken us a lot of places in earlier years, so he deserved the chance to get out there and play in the Super Bowl.
The gambling thing was initiated the week before the Super Bowl game. There's going to be a story out before the game about Lenny Dawson being involved in a gambling scandal. A gentleman by the name of Dawson in Detroit, Michigan, was raided, and in the process they found an address book and a phone book with a lot of phone numbers in it, one of which was Lenny Dawson's.
And they were trying to determine what to do about the situation. And I can remember they're all sitting around. I said, why don't we tell them the truth? I do know this person. I spoke to him twice this year, once when I injured my knee, and he asked how I was doing. Secondly, when my father passed away, to offer his condolences. I haven't seen this guy in I don't know how long. I really don't know him. I don't associate with him. I didn't know anything about his business. I said, that's the truth. And so, oh, yeah, maybe we'll do that.
I was enraged because of the obvious silliness of such a charge, because I knew Len Dawson very well, and there was no chance that he was going to be involved in, as they indicated, possibly throwing games.
We never believed the rumors about Lenny, and Lenny didn't even have to explain.
I think that Lenny just knew that the team and myself were in full support of it.
I think the one thing that made it a lot easier for me was that my teammates didn't believe a word of it.
When it was finally clear that, you know, Lenny didn't have no involvement, everything was straight, we just said, all right, let's put all this behind us. And we came out there and played Super Bowl IV.
Come on, Lenny! Pump it in there, baby! Just keep matriculating the ball down the field, boys!
You never knew that he had any kind of a problem during the course of the week. And I think that's why it has to be ranked as one of the great performances by a quarterback in the history of the National Football League because of what he had to go through the week of the game.
It was a very unsettling thing because they were right there during the time when he was trying to prepare for the biggest game of his life. And he, as he would often do, being Lenny the Cool, he had one of the great games he's ever had that day.
Go ahead, for Mike, Lenny Dawson.
The one thing that stands out about Lenny, when I think about Lenny, the bigger the game,
nice going, baby,
the better he played.
Play smart football to win for you. That was Lenny Dawson.